attached to it, which is basically the space of valuations. So it's the Berkovich identification with respect to the trivial absolute value. It's case number two, maybe, Matthias's talk. But anyway, so again, if you don't know what this is, I will repeat what happens in the toric case and you can keep this picture in mind. So the Berkovich space X is, so the space X an, it's a compact, a unit as a compact topological. Okay, so it's a compact topological space that you can think of as a compactification of the space of valuations. So valuations here are valuations on the field of your variety. And among these, you have divisorial valuations. They form a subset inside of the space of valuations, and therefore in this compactification, and it's a dense subset. So divisorial valuations are the ones that are attached to prime divisors on some birational model of X. It's vanishing order from such divisors. They are the geometrically more significant valuations. So if you want this space, it's a compactification of the space of geometrically significant valuations. And we consider functions on this Berkovich space. The way it works is that every time you have some Zariski open subset of X and some algebraic function on this open set, it defines for you a continuous function on the Berkovich space. So points in the Berkovich space are not all valuations, but they are semi-valuations. So it means they can degenerate somehow along some subvariety, but you can think valuations for simplicity. And then this function defines continuous function on an induced open set. So each open subset of X defines an open subset in the analytification. And this function here defines a continuous function, which is given by a rule like this. So it's a valuation, you can evaluate it on the function f that you view as a rational function, but you pass to this multiplicative point of view, multiplicative semi-norms, and you get a continuous function. So these conditions here prescribe the topology of the Berkovich space. Okay, so of course, I mean, if you never saw that before, it's all the whole flavor of it in a minute. But again, as I said, in the very case, suppose X space of continuous functions on X n that defines its topology. So it plays the role of smooth functions to some extent in this situation. So the way they are defined, so this is defined as the vector space generated by functions that you can cook up from the definition you got here. So you have functions that are locally, in this sense here, some Zariski open, given by translate by constant and take max, and also to divide by some rational number in order to get Q vector space. Okay, so basically differences of functions like that are going to be PL functions. So these ones look more complex PL functions. Okay, so far we don't see the polarization. Yeah, so I can say that again in the toric case, you can make sense of toric PL functions. So we have to say every PL function on X induced the usual rational PL function on R to the n. And conversely, every toric PL function is obtained from such a function like that. So if you restrict to the toric situation, this notion here is just the usual notion of this was in our function on R to the n. Okay, and now the way you use the polarization, so we have this L, this ample bimodal on X, which was chosen in the beginning. PL functions. Right. So the role these PL functions play for us, and the reason why we look at this setting is that they parameterize test configurations. So I'm not going to repeat the definition of test configurations, but I should say that PL functions, in the space of PL functions here, is in one-to-one correspondence with the set of test configurations for XL, but without any positivity condition imposed to the test configuration. Now, if you impose to the test configuration some ampleness or nefness, then that will correspond here to LPSH function. So if you take some PL function that corresponds to test configuration plus F, you will say that phi is LPSH. You can only if the corresponding test configuration is nice. Okay, so
sorry, this one-to-one correspondence, that's not only the toric case, or is it?
That's the toric case, that's in the general situation. So the PL functions, they parameterize these configurations, and here we impose some positivity on the test configurations, as we do when we define case stability, then we are dealing with, we say that the corresponding functions at PSH. Okay, so again, it's much too quick if you never saw it before, but in the toric case, it becomes something that we understand quite concrete terms. So if phi is a toric PL function, then phi will be LPSH, if and only if. Restrict. So we know that the restriction of phi describes FTSH functions in the complex situations, or PSH metrics on the line bundle. We have the same picture like that. Except that here we can directly restrict the function to NR because it lives in the language space. So case stability can be described as a condition that bears on all NPSH PL functions, the positivity of a certain invariant that we want to view as the analog of the K energy in this setting. So in order to say before about that, I next describe measures in this situation. So we have version of the Monjonpère operator in this context. So I will denote by H, script H, which depends on M, the space of DL PSH, PSH functions. Okay, so it's the space that corresponds to net test configurations, as I said. So to a function like that, can associate using calculus on the Jacobi spaces or various other approaches. that depends on L. So this is what we call the divisorial measure. So it's a probability measure on the Jacobi space, but that has a quite simple because it's just a finite convex combination of point masses at divisorial valuations. So it's basically taking convex combinations of divisorial valuations that you encode in a corresponding probability measure like that. So this correspondence can be defined in terms. So you need to know what the VIs and the MIs are. So I'm not going to do that now, but I can say that this can be described in terms of intersection numbers or using this more sophisticated approach of Chambard-Loire and Ducrot. But again, so if you just think of the toric case, then this is just the usual real Monjonpère operator. That's M historic. You take P, which is a toric function in this what is contained in NR, it consists of toric evaluations, and you are just computing the real one of that measure of it. So it's an R index function. Okay. So, for example, one function which is FDSH is the function which is any constant function is FDSH. The constant, so you can take it to be equal to zero, for example. And in that case, the corresponding monopair measure is just one Dirac mass at the trivial evaluation. It's a special measure in the Berkovich space. In the toric situation, it corresponds to the origin R to the end. I'm sorry? Yeah, sure, normalized. Correctly normalized to mask one. Because I'm normalized. These are probability measures. So, to normalize the measure to mask one. So now, if you believe that the formalism works as in the complex situation, then this monopair operator has a primitive. So the monopair operator has a primitive, which is certain functional defined in the same space. It means that if you take directional derivative, they are computed by integration against the corresponding monopair measure. So that's the monopair energy. Which, again, in the toric case, is given by, can be expressed in, conveniently in terms of the Laplacian transform as the integral of the corresponding convex function on the polytope. Divisor of valuations. We are just averaging the log discrepancy, taking some average of the log discrepancy of these valuations. So this is one term, and there is another term that we've got, which is the derivative of energy. So everything depends on F, really. And so when I say that it's a primitive, it means I'm differentiating in the direction of the function phi, but we can also differentiate in the direction of L. So that this is the direction of the derivative. We've got in the direction of the canonical bundle. So anyway, so there is some explicit formula like that where this is the entropy part, this is the energy part. And we see that the entropy part only depends on the Monge-Ampère measure. So the game we want to play is to view the energy part also as a function of the Monge-Ampère operator. So the Monge-Ampère operator has the property that it's translation invariant. If you translate function phi by a constant, you get the same Monge-Ampère measure, and then it becomes injective. So in other words, the Monge-Ampère measure of a function, an LPSH function phi, determines the function up to a constant. So that means that every time you have a function on H that is translation invariant, you can view it as a function of the Monge-Ampère measure. And this allows to view this thing here as a function of the corresponding Monge-Ampère measure. But this is what we want to understand a bit more. And then we will have, if we do that, then we will get an expression for the this k energy that now only involves the measure of u. And it means that we have traded the space of LPSH functions that depends on L with the space of divisorial measures that does not depend on L anymore. And so that allows us to better polarization. So in other words, we want a dual formulation of the case stability condition. We can think of as a evaluative characterization. Yeah.
same interpretation as the complex case. Okay, so let me end with stating that proof. So we are considering energy again. This is depending on L, everything on L, in fact. So what we show is that the dependence with respect to the polarization, if we fix such a usual measure, the function, the energy viewed as a function of the polarization, is a C1 differentiable function. And furthermore, if the measure corresponds to a certain function in H, then the derivative in any direction, the direction of derivatives of this function, continuous.